Good evening, gentlemen. How's everyone doing tonight? All right, I want to welcome you to Thursday Night Men's Study. It's good to have you here in the house. And those of you who are online watching us, it's good to have you join us. You guys hearing this okay? There's no prayer requests that I've received from the guys, but I'll just open up in prayer and just wherever the Lord leads me there. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for your presence here tonight, Father God. We just pray that you would have your way here, Lord. We just pray that hearts would be opened, minds would be opened, Father, that we'd feel your Holy Spirit speaking to us, Father. Whatever message that we individually need to hear, Father, we pray that we would receive that tonight, that we'd receive the healing emotionally, physically, whatever we need, Father God, that our eyes would be open, Lord, that we would know you more and come to know you and love you more too, Father God. So we pray you have your blessing here tonight, Father. Lord, I want to lift up our brother Ed Jeffers. Just pray you'd be with him. Just bless him, Father. Just heal him, Lord. Work that miracle in his body, Father. Father, we also want to lift up our brother Mike Bonomo. We just pray blessings upon him and his wife Lisa, Father, that you would just heal his heart over the loss of a close friend, Father, and just give him the rest he needs, and just give him a time of restoration, Father God. And for whatever other needs are here, Lord, we just pray that you would just, you know what's on our hearts. You know those that we love and where their hurts are, Father. We just pray you would just meet those needs. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
All right, we're finishing up chapter 15 and starting in 16 tonight. So let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your word. And Lord, just to be able to read what you have to say to us, that, Lord, we can come to your word continuously and just receive that nourishment we need for our souls, Lord. The world is constantly just dragging us down and Lord, just trying to destroy us. But, Lord, we know that in you we have victory. So, Lord, speak your word tonight and just, Lord, just whatever the need is for the men here and those that are listening online, we just thank you and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now, this is chapter 16. Things are, you know, it's getting a little bit tougher because Jesus is hours away from the cross, and he's now delivering a message to his disciples about what's going to happen to them, about what's going to happen in life. There's some things he's held back from them because they weren't ready for it. And it's the same thing in our lives. Sometimes things come later in our lives and we go, oh, now that makes sense. So Jesus was holding back. And, you know, John's narrative here, once again, you know, you say Jesus, but this is John's narrative. This is John's narrative about what he recollects about what went on. And remember, when we read this, it says, I said these things so that you would remember. And this is exactly what John's doing. John is 40 years past these events, actually longer than that because it was 90 AD. So we're talking about a long time, 60 years. That's almost as old as me. So, you know, it's one of those kind of things where, you know, he's recollecting, but it's this recollection is being brought back by the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God is so vital to us. And I think when we read this chapter, because Jesus is bringing it all together, the Father himself, and also the Spirit, the Holy Spirit that is going to come and dwell with us and in us, that will lead us into understanding. So let's go back and review Genesis, the first chapter. So anyway, the first chapter of Genesis, verses 26 and 27, it says, then God said, let us make mankind in our own image and our likeness. Verse 27 goes right on and he says, so God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. In those two verses, it switches from the plural to the singular. understand that when we're talking about the Trinity, when we're talking about the nature of God, it's not different parts. It's all, they're just different attributes of the same God. That God is created for his purpose in fulfilling his plan of salvation. Our God is three persons. One God, three persons before the creation of the world. God has always existed. He didn't come into existence. The Trinity, or the triune nature of God, it's a personal relationship right from the beginning. Right from the beginning, this triune God has communion. Communion with the Son, with the Spirit, the Father. You know, and if you haven't seen The Truth Project, I think Del Tackett does an awesome job. Uno Mystica. The mystery of the oneness of God. The Father's invisible, infinite outside of time. Jesus is the Son of God, enters time to save fallen man on a rescue mission. The Spirit of God comes and reveals all truth, empowers us to know and love God. The Son and the Spirit proceed from the Father. God's plan of salvation is set in motion. Right from the very beginning, from the moment man sinned, God started a reclamation. He started his plan to save broken and lost mankind. Now, last week, I finished up the last part of chapter 15. I'm going to go back and kind of bring us forward because this really carries from one end to the other. In verse 18, it said, if the world hates you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. Verse 20, remember the word that I said to you, a servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they kept my word, they will keep yours also. Verse 22, if I had not come and spoken to them, they would have no sin. But now they have no excuse for their sin. He who hates me hates my Father also. If I had not done among them the works which no one else did, they would have no sin. But now they have seen and also hated both me and my Father. They are without excuse. Why? Because by the things that he did, that nobody else did, they saw it. Also, they heard his word and they rejected it. They would have had no sin if these things hadn't been done. That doesn't mean that sin wasn't present. But what he's saying is, you have no excuse now. And then verse 25 says, but this happened that the word might be fulfilled, which is written in the law, they hated me without excuse. It is not logical to see the hatred that we see in our society for religious people. The anti-Semitism we're seeing right now, the hatred of the Jewish nation, the persecution of Christians. We saw in that one incident with the punter, kicker, for the Kansas City Chiefs. He gets up in front of a Catholic audience for a Catholic benediction and shares the word of God to them and the holiness of the marriage, the holiness and the joy of raising children. He didn't denigrate anybody, but man, they came full speed after him. Why? They don't want to hear it. That's why they tried to kill Jesus. That's why they were trying to take him all the time he was around. They hated him. Why? With no excuse. There was no excuse. What did he say to them? What did he say to them? He showed nothing but love for them. At the end of chapter 14, Jesus promises the Holy Spirit. And now this chapter is going to deal with now the coming of the Holy Spirit. Verse 26 from chapter 15, but when the Helper comes, whom I shall send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will testify of me. And you also will bear witness because You have been with me from the beginning. The Spirit of truth is going to testify, but also so are you, disciples. You are going to testify. But we see on their own, there's still a weakness there. But he's sending the Spirit not just to reveal truth. He's sending the Spirit to strengthen the redeemed. Then we go into verse 1, chapter 16. Jesus is warning, but comforting his disciples. I'm going to read verses 1 through verse 4. These things I have spoken to you, that you should not be made to stumble. They will put you out of the synagogues. Yes, the time is coming that whosoever kills you will think that he is offering God's service. And these things they will do to you because they have not known the Father nor me. But these things I have told you, that when the time comes, you may remember that I told you of them. And these things I did not say to you at the beginning because I was with you. Jesus, the whole time he was there, he protected the disciples. They were under his care. But the fact that he now knows he's leaving, he knows that now they're vulnerable. And so he's saying to them, I was here taking care of you, but I'm going. But I'm going to warn you about these things. They're going to try to kill you. Why? Because they hate me. They hate my Father. The disciples shared the same hope of the Jewish people generally, that the Messiah would set up his kingdom and that the power of Rome would be broken. This is what they saw. They saw a conquering Messiah. They never envisioned a suffering Messiah. This was not in the wheelhouse of the Jewish community. They did not see the suffering Messiah. Even though it was prophesied, what they saw was a conquering Messiah. Instead, the Lord told them that he was going to die. They thought he was going to take over. He was going to establish his kingdom. But he tells them, I'm going to die. But I'm going to rise again and go back to heaven. They did not understand. It did not compute with them. They did not understand his death and resurrection. The Holy Spirit would come, and the disciples would go out as witnesses for Christ. They would be hated and persecuted. The Lord told them all of this in advance so that they would not be disillusioned, made to stumble, or be shocked in some way. What was there for them was excommunication from the synagogue. And this was considered one of the worst things that could happen to a Jew, is to be refused to be able to go into the synagogue. Banishment. Excommunicated. Yet this would happen to those Jews, because they were disciples of Jesus. The Christian faith would be so hated that those who sought to stamp it out would think that they were pleasing God. They were doing God's work. This shows how that a very sincere person can so be so very sincerely wrong. Zeal is not enough. Enthusiasm is not enough. You better know what you're talking about. People don't even know why they hate. They just jump on the train and run along hating. They have no clue what they're chanting. They have no clue what they're saying. The failure is to recognize the deity of Christ. That was what we read right at first, the deity of Christ. He was God in the flesh. And that was the root of the problem. That was what created the problems. They did not see him. Even though they watched the miracles he did, they did not see his deity. The Jews wouldn't receive him. So Jesus says, if they won't receive me, they won't receive my Father. Again, the Lord warned the disciples in advance so that they would not be moved. These afflictions, when they happen, when these things had happened, it wouldn't destroy them. He wanted them to remember what he had said. He predicted their persecution. They would know that it was all part of God's plan. Acts 26, 9 to 11. This is Paul speaking to Agrippa, telling him about his conversion, about him becoming a disciple of Jesus. I too was convinced that I ought to do all that was possible to oppose the name of Jesus of Nazareth. And that is just what I did in Jerusalem. On the authority of the chief priests, I put many of the Lord's people in prison, and when they were put to death, I cast my vote against them. Many a time I went from one synagogue to another, to have them punished, and I tried to force them to blaspheme. I was so obsessed with the persecution, with persecuting them, that I even hunted them down in foreign cities. This is Paul the Apostle when he was Saul, when he was going around murdering Christians, throwing them into prison, hunting them down. He stood there in one of the most moving parts of is Stephen's testimony. When he was stoned, Paul is standing there giving approval. When Stephen looked into heaven and says, "Don't hold them responsible. They don't know what they're doing. Forgive them." The Lord had not told them much about this earlier because he was with them. Once again, while he was there, he was holding back. Two reasons for that. First of all, they wouldn't understand it. And the second thing is, he wanted to teach them so many other things. And so what he would do, he was holding back on these things that they would need to know approaching the cross when it was going to come down. But now he's leaving them, and he must tell them that the path is they're headed in. Verses 5, 6, and 7. "But now I go to him who sent me, and none of you ask me, 'Where are you going?' But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I depart, I will send him to you." The Helper, the Comforter, the Holy Spirit. Going back to verse 5, none of you have asked me where I'm going. Well, they did. They had to ask him. We'll go. We'll follow you. We'll go. Where are you going? We'll go with you. And he told him, he says, "You can't go with me." But it really just kind of get passed off. So when Jesus says this, they're not understanding what he's been telling them. It was almost like a disappointment in Jesus' voice. That you don't ask me, "Where am I going?" The disciples were not more interested in what was ahead for the Lord. Although they had asked in general, they just really weren't involved. It was like it just went right over their head. They were more concerned about their own future than was his. They were more concerned about their lives than what he was talking about he was facing. Before him laid the cross and the grave. Before them lay persecution and their service to Christ. They were filled with sorrow. Their own troubles they worried about rather than his. Nevertheless, they would not be left without help and comfort. Jesus knew what they needed. And he knew that the Spirit of God was coming forth from the Father to come into the world. Now, that doesn't mean that the Spirit wasn't in the world and acting in the world already. What he was doing is his emphasis was changing at this point. Christ would send the Holy Spirit to be their helper. It was to the advantage of the disciples that the helper would come, that he would empower them, give them courage, teach them, make Christ more real to them than he had ever been before. This was the change. The Spirit, once again, the Spirit was moving. The Spirit has always been there. The thing is now the Spirit is coming to indwell. And in Acts, Pentecost, he comes to the disciples first, the upper room, and then he comes to all of us at Pentecost. The Helper would not come. The Spirit of God would not come. The Comforter would not come until Jesus went back to heaven and was glorified. This is what Jesus is trying to explain to them, but they just don't have the concept. The Holy Spirit had been in the world before, but now it's a new way. It was here now to convict the world and to minister to the redeemed. Two parts, two things the Spirit is here for. It's to convict the world of their sin, to convict them of their unbelievable treatment of Jesus and their rejection of the Messiah, the rejection of God himself. That was the conviction. No matter what they had done, the greatest thing you can do is deny the deity of Christ, to deny what he has done for us. That's an unforgivable sin. But the Spirit is here now to convict and to minister. Now, going back to, in 16:7, he says, but if I go, I will send him to you. He says, I will send him to you. But if you go back to 14:26, it says, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name. In just such a short period of time, John has shown this, that Jesus is saying, I will send the Spirit, and the Father will send the Spirit. So, Jesus said, I only do what my Father shows me. But the thing is this is showing you the intimacy between the Father and the Son. Verse 8, and when he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin because they do not believe in me. Of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment because the ruler of this world is judged. It's really interesting. I was looking back in one of my old Bibles, the one I almost from the point of being a believer. I had this New Testament, and what it was like, I think it cost me $4.95 or something like that. And I had it rebound. It cost me more to rebind that thing than I originally purchased it for. But it was, I'm looking at it, these verses, and I had a question mark there. I had it blocked off in a question mark. Because I didn't, at that time, I didn't quite understand what this verse, verses 8, 9, 10, and 11, I didn't understand it. I don't know whether you guys have had things like that where you put a question mark next to something because it didn't make sense to you. But this is what John is talking about. As we grow and as we continue to read the Word of God, God reveals more to us. You get a certain amount of learning behind you, and then God goes, okay, now it's time to teach you something new. So the Holy Spirit would convict the world in respect to sin, and of righteousness, and of judgment. This is generally taken sometimes, and this is one of the things I thought at the time, that he creates an inward awareness of these things in the life of the individual sinner. And that made sense to me. That sounded right. But, people smarter than me looked at it a little deeper, and they helped me. While this is true, this is not exactly, they said, this is not the teaching. It's not about creating an inward awareness. The Holy Spirit condemns the world by the very fact that he is here. The Holy Spirit did not come in this capacity until Jesus had gone back to heaven to be with the Father. The very fact that the Spirit was now dwelling on the earth and in men, this is what condemns the world. Because Jesus should have stayed here. Jesus should have set up his kingdom. If everybody had really believed and really came to him, he would have established his kingdom. He knew it wasn't going to happen. This is why he planned it the way he did. He knew man's heart would reject him. But he would have been here. The reason the Spirit of God is now dwelling here among us and moving among people, it convicts the wickedness of the world, and at the same time, it strengthens us. The world rejected him when he went back to heaven. The Holy Spirit is here in place of the rejected Christ, and this demonstrates the world's guilt. The Spirit convicts the world of sin, of failing to believe in Christ. Believe on Christ. Because he was worthy of belief. There was nothing about him that was made it impossible to believe on him. There was nothing that Jesus did. No one could accuse him of anything. They tried to catch him. We read about those in the Gospels. We read about Jesus they're trying to trick him, to trap him. And the people are going, wow, this is blowing my mind. This guy, wow, nobody's ever talked like this. This guy's the wisdom that he has and the power, the authority he has. But humanity refuses to believe. The Holy Spirit's presence in the world is to witness to their crime. The Savior claimed to be righteous, but men said he was a demon. God spoke with the final words. He said, my son is righteous, and I will prove it by raising him from the dead and taking him back to heaven. He raised him up and took him back to heaven. He proved the righteousness of Jesus when he took him back to heaven. The Holy Spirit witnesses to the fact that Christ was right and the world was wrong. The presence of the Holy Spirit also convicts the world of the coming judgment. There is a coming day when God will come back and judge all of humanity. He will judge the whole creation because the curse was not just passed on mankind. The curse was passed on to the entire creation. And it says it travails and groans because of sin. The fact that he is here means that the devil has already been condemned at the cross and all who refuse the Savior will share that same awful judgment in that future day. Verse 12, I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them. However, when he, the Spirit of truth, has come, he will guide you into all truth. For he will not speak on his own authority, but whatever he hears, he will speak, and he will tell you things to come. He will glorify me, for he will take of what is mine and declare it unto you. Verse 15, all things that the Father has are mine. Therefore, I said that he will take of mine and declare it to you. He's going to take all things from God and declare it to you. Jesus has the authority. There's many other things that the Lord had to tell the disciples, but they couldn't handle it. That's what he said in verse 12. This is an important principle about teaching. There must be certain progress in learning before advancing truths can be received. You must build on it. We all had to build. When we first became believers, we had to build on what we were hearing. You keep coming back. And that's what Daniel said tonight. You keep coming back. You keep coming back. Whether it's singing songs of praise or whether it's reading the Word of God, you must keep coming back. Because every time you come back, you get something new, something different. It reinforces what you already believe. The Lord never overwhelmed his disciples with teaching. He never overwhelmed them. He was constantly teaching them, but he never overwhelmed them. He knew what they could handle. He knew what they were ready for. He knew where they were. Even when they stumbled, he knew that, and he was ready for it. He gave it to them line upon line, precept upon precept. Concept after concept. He gave them what they needed at the time. The work which the Lord began was to be continued by the Spirit of truth. What Jesus began, the Spirit picked up and continued it. This was orchestrated by the Father. He would guide them into all truth. There is a sense in which all truth was committed to the apostles in their lifetime. Say that again. All truth was committed to the apostles in their lifetime. That's where we got the New Testament from. They began to commit what they had learned in their writings. And now we have the New Testament. You take the New Testament, you take the Old Testament, it completes God's written word. But this is still true. He's not writing new scripture, but the Spirit is still guiding us constantly in truth. And the way he does it is through scripture. There's two revelations. There's general revelation and special revelation. General revelation is what you see out there. And I'm telling you, you should fall down on your face and you should worship God. If you look at the ocean, if you look at the mountains, you look at the clouds, you look at other human beings walking around and all the multitudes of animals, and you should fall down on your face and worship God. Because that is so miraculous, that is so incredible. When you see that amount of diversity, and yet you see them all existing in the same environment, that is general revelation. But the scriptures are what allow us to really understand, because I can worship the creation. If I don't know who is the creator, then I'm directing my worship in the wrong direction. That's what a lot of people do. They worship the creation. The Holy Spirit will only speak the things that are given to him, to say by the Father and the Son. He will tell you things to come. This, of course, is talking about the revelation that was given to John, which was revelation. The future unveiled. The Spirit's principal work will be to glorify Christ. That's what the Spirit does in us. It glorifies Christ. All this can be tested by teaching and preaching. But everything must, all teaching and preaching, must magnify Jesus, must magnify the Savior. Any teaching is not magnifying the glory of God, then it must be questioned. And the Holy Spirit is what does this. Jesus says, he will take what is mine What he means is the great truths that concern Christ. The things that he reveals to the believers, the things he reveals to us. And believe me, that's inexhaustible. The things that God can reveal to us is inexhaustible. All the attributes of the Father belong to the Son as well. It's these perfections that Christ was speaking of in verse 14. The Spirit unveiled to the apostles the glorious perfections of the Lord Jesus Christ. In concluding, Jesus warned his disciples persecution was coming. He was sending them a helper from God. Tells them he's going back to the Father. Because the world has rejected him, the Holy Spirit has come to condemn the world for unbelief. But for the believer, the Spirit has come to guide and teach into all truth. Spirit has come to glorify Jesus. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, Lord, because without it, we would just be just drifting about. We just need you to speak to our hearts. And Lord, we just thank you that you've given us your Spirit that comes to us and speaks to our hearts and Lord, shows us who you are so that we might fully embrace our God, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Free my heart, set free my soul. I don't want to be a prisoner no more. Unlock the door that holds me in. This is my